just to really motivate what I'm going to talk about today, I think it's fascinating if we look at what Sinan just talked about. At a high level, I could ask companies questions, really any company in the world, questions about their internal network, and who communicates with whom in a company, really simple questions that nobody can answer. You could say, you know, how much does the management team talk to the engineering team? Nobody knows. You can't even answer a question like, how much should a salesperson communicate with the customer? Which is crazy, right? I mean, you think about all the detailed data we typically collect about customers external to our company. And then when it comes to inside our organizations, we forget about all those things. We don't remember that we actually do have data about what people do at work. And so specifically, you know, today we have sensor data from ID badges, IoT sensors in the workplace. We have email, chat, meeting data. It's really rich data about what goes on at work. And so now that we have this, we can start to do things, as Sinan showed, like look at networks within the organization. Who talks to who, all those things, right? And so a lot of times, I'll be having a conversation with the company, and they'll ask me, you know, what is the best network? If I want to try to make for the best teams in my organization, right? I want to make them work in a certain way. So here's the best team, right? Again, I'm from Boston. Everyone knows where I'm from here. That's right. Yep. Woo! But so here's the question. So, okay, well, first a question. How many people here work in a technology company? A bunch. I figured a bunch. Okay, so, and the question I'll put to you is, if you're running a technology company, what is the best network to have at a technology company? So who thinks it should be a really cohesive network focused more on execution? Execution, no. Who thinks it should be focused, a little bit more diverse, focused on exploration and coming up with new ideas, things like that? No. Okay. A couple of people. Right? Who thinks it's neither? All right. So let's see. I think like literally 10% of people voted here. So, come on, we need predict, guys, the election's gonna come up in a couple years. We're gonna need people to actually vote. Okay, but the correct answer, right, is that the surprise is that there's none, and Sinan hinted at this earlier, right? But importantly, it's not just that it depends on, it's not just that for certain companies, a certain type of network is better, like if you're focused more on execution, that having a cohesive network is better, and if you're a company that's focused on innovation, you should have a more diverse network. It's that, depending on the work that you're doing any given day, any given week, any given month, your network needs to change. And it does change. Right? So who I talk to this week, this month, is different than who I communicate with next month. Right? Now, the difference is that the way we create these networks today is an incredibly ad hoc way. Right? I'll bump into people in the hallway and I'll start talking to them. Right? Maybe I have a meeting with you and then we start emailing each other later. But that's not directed with the same sort of thought that we put into, for example, org charts. But of course, those actually have a lot less of an impact on how we actually work. Right? And really what's fundamentally changed is our ability to measure these networks, right? That today, I have, for example, next generation sensor badges that look at who talks to who and how people talk to each other. Again, not recording what people say, but at a millisecond level, understanding across an organization of tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands, what's actually going on. Of course, we all already have email data today, and so then I know who emails who, I know who chats with who, I know who's meeting with who. And that enables us to look at these changes so quickly, day by day, week by week, month by month, and actually manage to that. It's just a very different way of managing an organization. And this gets to what Sinan hinted at earlier, the difference between exploration and exploitation. Right? That sometimes I need to actually exploit a resource, I need to execute a project, I need to build a thing. And sometimes I need to come up with new ideas. I need to break out of my silos, do other things. Right? But depending on what you're working on a given week, one or the other network could be different, could be more effective, right? So let's get concrete here. One of the things that we do in my company is, again, we use sensor data, digital data, to understand if people interact and collaborate at work. And one of the companies we looked at was a multi-billion dollar IT firm, where the employees in one of these divisions were creating these multi-million dollar data servers for their customers. So most of these people have master's degrees. It's this very complex task. Basically, they get a call from a salesperson, you know, says company XYZ needs a server that does these sort of things. They actually configure the server in their software. They price it out. They send it out to them. What's interesting about this, though, is that even though it's a very complex task, you're able to measure their performance pretty accurately. Essentially, look at completion time, from when they're assigned a task to when they complete it. How long did that take? If it's very simple, it took them 5 minutes. If it was very complex, it could take them up to 8 hours. And so the question is, right, what do the most effective people do? But before we answer that, if we just step back for a second, let's think about, you know, imagine you're working on a task, right, and imagine you have a question about how to complete it. And what you'll do is you'll probably go try to find an expert to talk to. You'll find somebody like Al, right? But the thing is that at a company, there's not just one Al, right? There's many Al's. And actually what we found at this company were there were four people, four informal experts, who if you spoke to had a pretty massive impact on how quickly you completed a task. But this gets very interesting, right? Because if I looked at in general, let me look at who communicates with who actually talks with who in general across a whole month. And what you saw was that the types of networks that for that month correlated with higher performance was having very cohesive networks. As Sinan mentioned, if you, the people I talk to talk a lot to each other, those people completed tasks very quickly. Essentially, people with the most cohesive tasks would complete, with cohesive networks, would complete tasks 50% faster than people with the least cohesive networks. Pretty strong effect. And you would see these informal experts were scattered throughout the network, right? And there wasn't really a correlation between their position and performance. Okay? But then if we just said, let's look at who communicates with who when they're working on a task. And then it looked very different. Basically, you saw these informal experts at the center of a network. And when and that's how you identified them, right? They had the same job titles as everybody else. But you saw that these people, one of these four people, over the course of a month, almost everybody talked to them at some point when they were working on a task. When you talk to one of those people, you completed that task in a third of the time that it normally took you. So it's a massive effect. But here's what's really interesting, right? These informal experts had statistically average performance individually. And this is because we're measuring performance on an individual level. I care about your output. So if you look at how quickly these informal experts complete a task, they looked identical to everybody else. And a big reason was they were spending on average about 4 hours a day helping their coworkers. Now this is a problem because here's the thing, I want this behavior if I run an organization. Right? I want them to help other people in the company. Right? If I make 20 people I work with 10% more effective, and I spend 6 hours of my time talking to them, I mean that should be my job. But if you can't quantify that, if I can't see that I need this network change in a very specific period of time, right? It's an interesting trade-off, right? That I want, in general, I want cohesive networks, right? But then specifically for these in-task networks, I want people to have very different types of behaviors. You're talking about I need to change a whole bunch of things. And in particular, this company tried to change incentives. Right? So what they did is originally, again, they paid people based on individual performance. Right? They said, if you complete tasks more quickly, we pay you more. And the challenge here, again, is that if I'm an informal expert, I will get paid the same as everybody else. But what they actually did is they changed incentives. They said, well, we're actually gonna have a group performance target. And if we hit that performance target, everybody gets a bonus. Right? So you're trying to incentivize people to help the group out. In addition, what they did, which I really like, is they had every employee at the end of the day would, they'd go around in a circle and they would call out one person who helped them that day. Really for the informal benefits there. Because frankly, today, that's why these informal experts were engaging in this behavior. It's because they wanted to help out their coworkers. And what we can do today is with the proliferation of data about what's happening at work, is I can quantify even at in a 1 minute level, in a what's happening. Are these interactions happening? Are they positive? Are they negative for the organization? And I think that importantly, when we take this view, we start to understand how, when we think about productivity, both at an individual and a corporate level, again, we like to think about, especially in the US, like the amount of stuff you produce, right? The number of emails you answer, the number of reports you write. And again, I think that's completely the wrong way to look at it. I mean, of course, you would, at the end of the day, need some work to get done. But importantly, the way that really we improve the output of the group, that's really what we care about. And in order to do that, right, we can't just focus on getting the right answer for today. Because what works today could not work next month or next year. And so really to make sure that we understand these patterns, we see them changing over time, and we're able to look at what actually maps to outcomes, that's what's really critical. So it's funny because Sinan showed literally the exact same slide. I think what a lot of the work that we've done is about looking over very large groups of people and trying to see the trends, the network patterns that correlate to outcomes, and then using that to, again, plan changes. But the point is that's not a one-time thing. Like a lot of companies, they'll maybe hire some consultants, they'll try to develop a new training program, let's say, and they'll roll that out, and they'll think that works for all time. But of course, you know, 5 or 10 years later, they realize it didn't work, or it doesn't matter anymore today. And I think that because now we have this dynamic information about what goes on in the organization, we can start to just admit that we actually, first of all, don't know what works today, but also we could admit that these things change really rapidly. And so by seeing how our networks are changing day by day, week by week, month by month, and relating that to outcomes, we can actually start to understand, you know, how we can evolve our organization along with the network. So that's all I got. Thanks very much.